के साथ रहती है।
All right, so let's take those two big points, those two big headlines, and open this up to our debate tonight. Joining us on the panel, Sangeeta Reddy is the president of FICCI and the joint managing director at the Apollo Hospitals Group. Dr. Niranjan Hiranandani is the president of NARITCO and ASSOCHAM, and also the founder and chief of Hiranandani Real Estate. Sunil Alag is chairman of SKA Advisors. And our political guest tonight, Rajiv Pratap Rudi of the BJP and Sushmita Dev of the Congress Party. Let me start with you, Sangeeta Reddy. You know, the two broad themes that were outlined by the Home Minister in that interview to News 18 Network. He believes that in a post-COVID world, if India were to buy, if every Indian were to buy Swadeshi, to buy Indian, we would actually become a global force to reckon with in a post-COVID world, which is going to be very different. You've heard what the Prime Minister's vision of an Atmanirbhar Bharat is. Do you believe this is a time for a fundamental reset for how we perceive the economy, how businesses perceive the economy, and how ordinary Indians perceive the economy?
I believe that the COVID scenario has led everybody to rethink multiple scenarios. But I think towards a self-reliant India, it's important for us to understand the journey, to make a clear plan in terms of the time it'll take, the money it'll take, the people and the resources it'll take to get there. The trend is directionally correct in one aspect, in that India is undoubtedly one of the largest markets. Mm. However, we must appreciate the fact that we are part of a global economy. Our service sector is very dependent on international markets. Critical manufacturing aspects come from abroad. So this, I believe, is a slow but steady transition towards being more self-reliant. Buying Indian, buying local, especially in food production, is a good trend.
Okay.
But does India want to shut itself off from the global markets? Absolutely not. I think we need to find the right balance. And right now, what is most critical is to restart the economy safely,
sure,
to continue to fight the corona battle well, and then to restart the economy by creating demand stimulation.
So are we ready for that? Today is the 1st of June. We are entering something called Unlock 1.0. Sunil Alag, from the fight that we've seen so far, India has done relatively better than most Western countries, more developed countries. I mean, the United States today has 18 lakh cases. India is just approaching 2 lakh. Even the fatality rate is much, much lower in India than compared to many of the Western countries. Are we ready for Unlock 1.0, Sunil Alag?
You know, I don't want to get into are we ready or not. It's a necessity today to be actually going for Unlock 1. For 60 days, over 60 days, we've remained locked. But the point is that, look, the responsibility now lies on the people. It doesn't rely on with the prime minister or the state ministers anymore. If we behave responsibly, if we wear our masks, if we keep a distance, and if the factories start operating based on whatever they've said, then that's what's going to happen. Even if there's a hike in the spike, which is bound to happen now, because if you see people will start walking down the road, very difficult to convince everybody to follow the rules, and there will be a spike. But gradually, I think it's about time that we opened up. And where Sangeeta Reddy says that we've got to also understand what the Home Minister has said. He's not at all talking about buying only Indian products. He's talking about buying products which are made in India. It doesn't mean you stop buying Toyota. It doesn't mean it stop buying Honda. It doesn't mean you stop buying Apple, as long as it's not made outside. You don't import it. So he's encouraging the make in India situation,
no,
even if it's a foreign brand.
Sunil, so far, let's take cars as an example, right? Many of them are being assembled in India. Many of the parts are coming from a global supply chain.
Many
of them are probably being assembled in India.
If you take Toyota, they are very rarely assembling now. They are making it in Bangalore. Why don't you talk to Mr. Vikram Kirloskar, who heads CII? Mm. And he will tell you that they are making it here. So he wants gradually every car, Suzuki, it's made in India. Now, come on. I mean, Nestle is not going to shut shop because Maggi is made in India.
Okay.
I mean, Britannia makes the biscuits here. So it's about time. It's not something that's going to happen overnight.
Okay.
It is a gradual movement.
Let me go across to our political spokespersons, yeah, Rajiv Rudi and Sushmita Dev. Rajiv Rudi, how do you convince folks that be Indian, buy Indian is not a anti-globalization move. It's not, setting us back to the licensed Raj. It's not taking us to a pre-liberalization days of 1991.
Well, I think no one in the world had experienced COVID and such a situation. And what I see the world across, the growth is slumped and it shall slump further. And so is India. Having said that, what is most important today, as economists say, to increase consumption and thereafter simultaneously also increase the supply side and also infuse liquidity in the market for this economy to get boosted up. What I read across the world today, so everyone is becoming inbound and inclusive, and that is the two features which are become essential to all the economies of the world. And possibly we have always felt that India is the largest market of the consumption across the world. So possibly, and not possibly, and definitely, the Prime Minister keeping that in mind. And all the SOPs which have been announced and financial infusion and the relaxations which have been given to the MSME sectors is A, when you talk about the increasing and improving the ease of business, which has from 142 in 2014, it has come down to 62. It certainly means more investment back in India, more people wanting to invest in India, more situation amicable for it. And at the same time, we have to create the capacity which we Indians have, as we had in the software or the services sector. We are doing what we were doing exactly in the agriculture sector. But manufacturing, of course, is something which we need to address.
Okay.
And the nearest competitor in manufacturing is, of course, in hardware, of course, is China. And I think India does have the capacity to increase the manufacturing capacity. And that is why the Prime Minister has talked about self-reliant. And that is why the Prime Minister has talked about being inbound.
Okay.
And I look at the market which belongs next to
us. I just want to play out. One of the criticisms of the government policy so far has been that, you know, money has not been put directly into the accounts of people. This question was asked to Mr. Amit Shah in that interview to the News 18 network. And this is what he said. He said already 53,000 crores have been deposited directly by DBT to various bank accounts. Can I just play out that portion? And this was also a political charge that was made by Rahul Gandhi. And then I'll come and ask Sushmita Dev to respond to it. But let me just play out that chunk where our News 18 network editor-in-chief, Rahul Joshi, asked Mr. Amit Shah about this specific political charge against the government. And this is how Mr. Shah chose to respond.
राहुल गांधी जी ने कुछ जी बड़े इकोनॉमिस्ट से सलाह की है, बातचीत की है, बातचीत की है, रघुराम राजन जी से बातचीत की है, उन्होंने अभिजीत बैनर्जी से बात करके ये कहा कि ये पैसा जो है माइग्रेंट लेबर को सीधा देना चाहिए था। तो कोई स्पेशल पैकेज सरकार सोच रही है प्रवासी मजदूरों के लिए आने
नहीं,
वाले
नहीं,
समय
मैं आपको बताता हूँ, हमने देखिए राहुल जी एक उनकी योजना लेकर घूम रहे, 7,500 रुपये हर एक के बैंक अकाउंट में डाल दो। चुनाव में भी उन्होंने न्याय नाम से योजना घुमाई थी, मगर देश की जनता ने उसको रिजेक्ट कर दिया। वो जानते नहीं है कि योजना रिजेक्ट हो चुकी है और एक साल हो गया, फिर भी कैसेट वहीं बज रही है। मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूं, कुल 41 करोड़ लोगों को 53,000 करोड़ रुपया भारतीय जनता पार्टी की नरेंद्र मोदी सरकार ने सीधा डीबीटी के माध्यम से इनके बैंक अकाउंट में पहुंचा है। जनधन योजना में जिनके अकाउंट है ऐसे 20 करोड़ अकाउंट को 20,000 करोड़ रुपया पहुंचा है और 500 रुपया पहुंचने वाला है, तो और 10,000 करोड़ पहुंचेगा। वरिष्ठ नागरिक, विधवा बहनें और दिव्यांगजनों के लिए 3 करोड़ नागरिकों के लिए 2814 करोड़ गए हैं। 8.2 करोड़ किसानों को 16,394 करोड़ रुपया भेजा है। भवन निर्माण क्षेत्र में काम करने वाले श्रमिकों, कंस्ट्रक्शन में काम करने वाले श्रमिकों को 4,000 करोड़ रुपया सीधा उनके बैंक अकाउंट में गया है। और उज्ज्वला योजना के तहत 7.5 करोड़ मुफ्त सिलेंडर लाभार्थियों को पहुंचाया है। आप सिलेंडर की कॉस्ट गिन लीजिए तो 1600 रुपया हर एक के वहां गए हैं और एक सिलेंडर अभी जाने वाला है। और 36 प्रदेशों में 98,00,000 मैट्रिक टन गेहूं और चावल हमने बांटने का काम किया है फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट। और अरहर दाल लगभग 4.5 लाख मैट्रिक टन अरहर दाल सभी राज्यों में भेजी है और लगभग 2,00,000 मैट्रिक टन से ज्यादा वितरण भी हो चुका है। ये कैश, ये नकद सहाय नहीं है तो क्या है? ये नकद सहाय ही है। मगर राहुल जी कुछ लोग वक्र दृष्टा होते हैं, जिनकी दृष्टि ही वक्र है तो चीज कभी सीधी नहीं दिखाई पड़ेगी उनको, और वक्र दृष्टा लोगों को देश की जनता बहुत अच्छे तरीके से जानती है, ना गंभीरता से उनको लेती है ना उनके कहे में आती है।
All right, Sushmita Dev, I don't know what Vakradrasht means. I'm sure your Hindi is better than mine. But he has directly taken on this criticism against the government that they're not putting money directly in the hands. He has said that 53,000 crores have been spent through DBT and 41 crore people have benefited because of that. How do you respond?
You know, Jaka, one of the earlier persons on this show spoke about the fact that while you ignite the supply side, you have to ignite the demand side. Now, you're giving women and widows and disabled people 500 rupees and 1,000 rupees. I mean, I ask your expert panelists, and that's how you introduced them at the beginning of the show, is this enough for you to manufacture cloth or any other product in the economy? Will this create enough demand? Answer that simple question. It's as simple as that. It is not what Rahul Gandhi ji is saying and what Amit Shah is saying and what happened in the Lok Sabha election. It's a simple, basic principle of economy. You cannot expect a manufacturer to take a loan from the government, however good the terms and conditions of the loan are, if people are not going to spend money, i.e. demand. You think 500 rupees in a woman's account creates demand? If your
no, but that's only one component, Sushmita. That's only one component.
Okay,
there have been other direct benefit transfer components that have been outlined.
Okay. So why don't you ask your experts on the panel who are from the industry that if they are happy with this package on the demand side, then that's good.
Okay.
Good luck to them.
Let me put that to Mr. Hiranandani. He works in the construction business. Many are saying the biggest hit is going to be because of the migrant labor going away. The biggest hit is going to be on the construction business. Tell me, Mr. Hiranandani, are you, as we go into Unlock 1.0, are you worried that this migrant labor is not going to come back and therefore your businesses are going to find it harder to restart?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there is no doubt about it that the migrant labor which has just gone is going to take a couple of months before it can come back. I was very happy to hear the announcement today that the railways have already started 200 trains per day, so which are not relating to the return of migrant labor. So I think that's a good beginning to start with. But you are absolutely correct. I think two aspects of it really need to be flagged off. Number one, that it will take some time for the migrant laborers to come back, especially those people who have walked the distance there. I think there will be a certain fear which is there against the cities, because the cities are still having the COVID story which is flared up. I think both these issues are there. And the second point is, this has been flagged off by CII, FICCI and ourselves in ASSOCHAM, that what we did feel is that on the demand side, there could be some other emphasis that could have been made in order to kickstart the economy. My personal belief is that once the opening out is complete, I think they will take up some issues which will happen, maybe something like a GST cut or some other method by which the demand could be further there. But okay. One thing we must flag off on benefit of the demand side is the fact of the loans given to SMEs.
Yes.
I think with that 100% guarantee, at least that segment and NBFCs
will
have
benefit.
Been taken care of. But the rest of the economy will need some other demand driver to be taken. Or, for example, aviation or hotels, for that example.
Yeah.
I think these sectors will need a demand push of a different order in order to take it to the next level.
Let me just play out one more portion and I'll go back to Rajiv Rudi as well as Sushmita Dev on this back and forth that's been going on about migrant labor. Mr. Shah was asked about, you know, whether the government should have thought this through, whether there needed to be a more than 4-hour notice before the lockdown was imposed. Maybe there should have been Shramik trains run from the beginning of April or the end of March to ensure that the migrant labor got to their respective home states or their destinations. This is how Mr. Shah responded.
Amit Shah ji, ek chitra jo is puri mahamari mein Bharat se ubhar kar aaya hai, wo hai migrant labor ka. प्रवासी मजदूर का। जगह जगह पर देखा गया है कि प्रवासी मजदूर जो है वो अपने घर से निकल पड़े हैं, बड़े शहरों को छोड़कर अपने गाँव की ओर जा रहे हैं, पैदल चल रहे हैं और बड़ी बड़ी उनको बड़ी संकटों की जो है समस्या से निपटना पड़ा है। क्या आपको लगता है कि सरकार ने जब ये लॉकडाउन अनाउंस किया था तो कुछ जल्दीबाजी कर दी, कुछ दिन अगर रुक जाते, थोड़ा माइग्रेंट लेबर की भी बात सोचते, उनको पहले गांव भेज देते और उसके बाद लॉकडाउन लगाते, तो क्या वो ज़्यादा ठीक रहता?
देखिए, ऐसा कहना उचित नहीं है। अगर पहले उनको भेजने की व्यवस्था करते तो स्टैम्पेड होने की पूरी संभावनाएं थी। गांवों में अभी स्वास्थ्य सेवाएं तैयार भी नहीं हुई थी, राज्य भी उनको लेने के लिए तैयार नहीं हुए थे। उस वक्त हमारी क्वारंटाइन करने की व्यवस्था भी ठीक नहीं थी और टेस्टिंग व्यवस्था भी अभी बन रही थी हमारे देश की, और ये सारा 2 महीने के अंदर हमने तैयार किया। और मैं जहां तक प्रवासी मजदूरों का सवाल है आपको कहना चाहता हूं, जिस दिन से लॉकडाउन आया राज्य सरकारों ने कैंप लगाए हैं, उनकी भोजन की व्यवस्था करी है और केंद्र सरकार ने 11,000 करोड़ रुपया SDRF फंड के तहत, NDRF फंड के तहत राज्यों को दिया है, जिसके माध्यम से कलेक्टर एक कैंप लगाकर सभी प्रवासी मजदूरों को भोजन करा सके। और 1 मई से हमने ट्रेनें भी शुरू कर दी, उसके पहले 20 अप्रैल से बस सेवा शुरू करी और बस सेवा के माध्यम से लगभग 41 लाख श्रमिक आसपास के राज्यों में भेजे, जैसे गुजरात से राजस्थान जाना है, महाराष्ट्र से गुजरात जाना है, आंध्र से तेलंगाना जाना है, तेलंगाना से केरल जाना है, कर्नाटक से केरल जाना है, इस प्रकार के नजदीक के राज्यों के अंदर जो श्रमिक प्रवासी मजदूर जाना चाहते थे उनको बसों के माध्यम से लगभग 41 लाख लोगों को पहुंचाया गया और सारे के सारे श्रमिक, 41 लाख श्रमिक सरकारी खर्चे से पहुंचे हैं। 1 मई से श्रमिक ट्रेन चालू कर दी गई, लगभग 4,100 से ज्यादा श्रमिक ट्रेन अब तक चल चुकी है और 55 लाख श्रमिक मजदूर अपने गंतव्य स्थान पर पहुंचे हैं। मैं स्वीकार करता हूं कई लोगों को तकलीफ पड़ी है, उनके लिए हमारी भी संवेदना है, देश के प्रधानमंत्री की भी संवेदना है, सभी राज्य के मुख्यमंत्री भी द्रवित, परंतु ऐसा नहीं है कि व्यवस्था नहीं हुई है। कुछ लोग धैर्य खो बैठे और रोड पर चलना शुरू कर दिए, तब भी हम मूक दर्शक नहीं बने, हमने रोड पर बसें चलाई और बसों के माध्यम से लाइन पर के किसी रेलवे स्टेशन पर उनको पहुंचाया गया और रेलवे से उनके गांव तक पहुंचाने की व्यवस्था करी गई, फिर भी कई लोग रोड पर गए हैं। मैं इतना ही कहना चाहता हूं कि जो लोग सरकारी व्यवस्था से ट्रेनों के माध्यम से गए, इनके किराए का भी मुद्दा उठाया जाता है, मैं आज स्पष्ट करना चाहता हूं आपके कार्यक्रम के माध्यम से, सबका किराया राज्य सरकारों ने उठाया है 15%, खर्चे का 85% रेलवे ने उठाया है, भारत सरकार ने उठाया है।
All right, so that was Amit Shah saying that the reason why the government did not run shramik trains or special buses in the late part of March or in the early part of the lockdown in early April was because those states where the migrant labor hails from, UP, Bihar, Bengal, etc., their medical infrastructure was not ready at that time. That's why the lockdown was in effect to try and buy time. Rajiv Pratap Rudi, my question is this. Now, in the last few days of May and possibly going into June, what we are seeing, and you're well aware of this because you hail from Bihar, is that the number of cases in these states, UP, Bihar, Bengal, even Assam to a great extent, has suddenly shot up because of migrant labor coming back. So whether you did it in April or whether you did it now, the cases were going to go up anyway. We could have avoided these scenes.
Well, I'll come back to a few things. I've been listening to you. And unfortunately, Sushmita has forgotten her colleagues who speak economics. And we have been colleagues in parliament. So, Sushmita, it was me who said that supply and demand issue which I was raising. But nonetheless, she said about something about the SMEs. And I don't think she remembers the figures which the government has come forth with. And right from the starting from the package, which was 1,70,000 crores, in which more than 80 crore people were provided kind, that was food which was distributed through the PDS. And subsequently, all that which went to the 20 crore women of the Jandhan account, which got 500 rupees per month for the next 3 months, and those 1,000 rupees ex gratia to all those elderly and the senior citizens and disabled and so forth and so on. And the collateral-free
20 lakh, we know all this, Mr. Rudy. Mr. Rudy, we know
so
all this.
So I think she has forgotten all that.
Sure.
So I'll come back to your question now because I can't. So you're talking about Bihar, UP. Unfortunately, I was looking through the figures, and if you look at something which is very interesting, all these people who came back, it was either to Bihar, Jharkhand, Uttar Pradesh, Orissa, and unfortunately they came from rich states like Punjab, Haryana, Delhi, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil, and Karnataka, and so forth. Something which was very good about the southern states, that they really looked after the people who were there, and that is something a lot of credit goes. But this did not actually happen in the northern states. But let's not forget, let's forget it for a while. Now, when you talk about Bihar today has more than 40 lakh migrants who have come back. We had the least, and that was the time when the chief minister of Bihar, who actually acted like a statesman, and said that he would agree to whatever the central government decides. And then he allowed, when the trains started coming in, he has set up more than 5,000 quarantine centers. Trains after train came to the state of Bihar. Naturally, there were people who came in who were infected. And this is what they initially, at least now we were prepared to handle them. And the credit goes to the prime minister, who at least in the last 2 months, prepared the nation how to handle them. But this was a difficult situation for all these states.
Okay.
And most of the time I find that those who are the states who threw them out are shedding crocodile tears. And we are happily taking back our brothers. And unfortunately, these are nationalist Biharis, these are nationalist UPIs, these are nationalist Jharkhandis, these are nationalist Oriites. And we are taking them. So it is a danger, but nonetheless,
okay.
This is the state government of Bihar or UP has done exceptionally well. The officers there, they are doing an exceptional job.
So this is the challenge. The last point.
India records the highest recovery rate, which is 47%. We have the lowest death rate. We have the lowest infection rate.
Okay.
All this credit goes to the Prime Minister.
Okay. Let me get Sushmita to respond. I think it's a legitimate point to say that if there was a migrant exodus in the last week of March, in the first week of April, clearly states like UP, Bihar, Bengal, even Assam, where you hail from, would have found it very difficult to deal with this migrant influx. The health infrastructure in these states simply does not have the capacity to deal with them. That's why their return back home had to be staggered in this nature.
I think that's the most insensitive comment I've ever heard in my life. The lockdown started on 24th March. Amit Shahji made a fatal admission that no preparation was made to take them back till 1st May. You left those people where they are without food. Mr. Rudy, I'll send you 500 rupees or 1,000 rupees in your account. How many days will you survive buying food? Answer that question. I'll send you 1,000 rupees in your bank account. Can you survive from 24th March to 1st of May? Buying food from that money, 11 crore people are outside the PDS system. You kept them waiting from 24th March to 1st May, as per Amit Shah's own admission in the last interview. I mean, is this government of the people, for the people? I ask myself, if state governments were not prepared, if that's your argument, then you should have started preparing from February. Instead, you prepared for Donald Trump to come to India. That's what you did.
Okay.
Thank you very much for exposing yourself.
Okay, Mr. Rudy, quickly respond, because then I want to go back to my expert panel.
I appreciate that if you don't have an argument, you can always create a shrill. And that's very not unusual with politicians. And that is what my friend Sushmita has done. But let's not forget, when you have a lockdown, that is the
Donald
time 1,000 rupees goes into your account, even 5,000 goes into your account, you don't go out shopping. You require kind and you require food, which was given through the PDS system. And 31,000 crores was released on the CESS workers' fund.
Okay.
The states had to give it to the workers. So the government and the state governments accept that, unfortunately, most of the states do not have a Congress government. So the shrill is understandable. But unfortunately, what I have felt is, the states have done an exceptional job, the center has done an exceptional job, and the leadership of the Prime Minister has been acknowledged across the world.
Okay.
Boris Johnson has failed, Donald Trump has failed. All these developed nations.
I'm just going to go back to experts. Sushmita, you've had enough of a chance. Mr. Rudy, one second. Let me go back to Sangeeta Reddy, to Sunil Lalag, and to Mr. Hiranandani. And the moot point that I want to expand on now is, today we've started Unlock 1.2. I just want to take our viewers to the magic wall and give you a sense of where we are as we look at Unlock 1.0. Right now, India is at 1,90,000 cases. We are fast approaching 2 lakhs. We'll possibly cross 2 lakhs tomorrow, if not latest by Wednesday. 8,300 cases have been added in the last 24 hours. For me, the big worry continues to be this. The number of active cases, the addition every 24 hours, is substantial. The number of recoveries, yesterday there were 4,800 recoveries in 24 hours, 3,300 more additions. That needs to improve. That needs to improve substantially. What has happened since the lockdown started easing up? Here you go. This is the case curve, as it were. Take a look at this. From about the 26th, 27th of May, the average addition of cases has gone up from 6,000 to 7,000, now 8,300. As more and more parts of the economy start opening up, as more and more people get back to their daily routines, this number will keep increasing. The number of new infections every 24 hours will keep increasing. Take a look at where India stands vis-a-vis the rest of the world. Last week, this time, last Monday, India was just in number 10 position. Today, exactly a week later, India is in number 7 position. It's gone past France and Germany at 1,90,000 cases. If we are going to grow at 8,000 cases, 9,000 cases, possibly even 10,000 cases a day in the next few weeks, then maybe by the middle of June or latest by the third week of June, we will hit number 2 position. We will be second only to the United States. The question is then, Sangeeta Reddy, you run, you know, one of the largest chains of hospitals in this country. Expert after expert has been saying the single biggest reason why COVID is so deadly is not because of the mortality rate, not because, you know, a large number of people succumb to it fatally, but because of the pressure it puts on your hospital system. This is a Hobson's choice. This is a dilemma. We have to open up the economy, and as we open up the economy, the number of cases will rise. How do we deal with this dilemma?
So I think this is a significant question because it's a matter of lives and livelihoods, as been said multiple times before. But right now it's very clear that we've had over 60 days to prepare the health systems to prepare for our medical response. At a death rate in India of 2.9% versus the global average of 5.9%, yeah. I think India's done a good job so far on the medical front. I think what is significant right now is to appreciate the fact that we have to go into this Unlock 1.0. And in Unlock 1.0, it's important for everybody to acknowledge and recognize that the onus of prevention, protection, good behavior moves now to society. The healthcare workers were the front line of defense. Now society and individuals have to become the front line of defense, and healthcare workers will continue to take care of the very sick. We have to brace ourselves for the fact that unless we are careful, this thing will continue to rise. I think it's